offers, and then we're going to talk about pomegranates. In particular, we're going to talk about the fruiting types and ornamental types, and we'll have a little time for questions, hopefully, at the end. All right, so for myself, I started with Repository in 1992 as a student. I started working in the greenhouse. I was going to UC Davis at the time, working on my degree in biology. And so that's where I really kind of started to learn about pruning techniques and about fertilizing and all the work that we do there, and really where I kind of cut my teeth on propagation in general. In 1994, when I graduated, the great fortune was that there was a position that was open in the field. I applied for it and got that particular position, and spent the next, four and a half years working out there. So I got to get to know the various varieties of all kinds of crops that we had at the repository. Really enjoyed my time out there. But in 1998, I got an opportunity to come back to the Davis location and work as the greenhouse manager there, and that's where I've been ever since. And then, as you can see, in 2001, kind of what's important for today, the then curator, Dr. Chuck Simon, appointed various people as the for minor crops as the point person to go to for asking questions and that kind of thing. And at that time, pomegranates were really a minor crop. And the thing I laugh about at this point in time is I'm certain that Chuck thought that, hey, this isn't going to take any time away from Jeff's job. It won't be a problem at all. And, you know, we've just seen the interest just escalate through the roof over the last bunch of years. And it's been really exciting to get to see that happen. And in some ways to kind of be the center of, you know, because we've got such a great collection there that people are coming to from all around the world. All right, so we're going to talk about vegetative propagation. Oops. There we go. So we have a picture of dormant cuttings, as you can see. This is the kind of material that you guys would receive from us in the winter. Effectively, and we're going to go into it a little deeper a little later. You guys place an order, and this would be the material that you get. Oh, let's say close to 16 inches or so in length. So really long enough to make two cuttings out of. What's ultimately really important about this is you better know your top from your bottom. And so, or it's not going to work very well. So the way we set that up is we make a slanted cut on the top and a flat cut on the bottom. And then when I prepare a cutting, I would make a fresh cut just below a node. And then, as we'll see in a second, treat it with rooting hormone. In this particular case, it's 0.2% NAA. I use Root Dome because it's easy, it's readily available. You can use Hormex, or you could use a liquid hormone like Dip and Grow, or if you want a sulfate IVA, that's fine too. But like I said, this is readily available. It also comes with thymeram in it, so a fungicide. I don't have a problem with the pomegranates, but say with the figs that we propagate, I find that that's a little better, a little less rot. All right. So here we have a picture of basically a seed flat. So this is what I would typically put the cuttings into. These are actually mulberry cuttings that we're looking at. Say about 4 inches deep, 12 inches wide, 24 inches in length. And I use a 1-to-1 by volume perlite vermiculite media. And one thing I should say about any time that you use perlite or vermiculite, wear a dust mask. Really hard on your lungs. Not a problem once it's wet, but when it's dry, there's dust flying everywhere. And so I definitely make certain that that's what we do. Okay, so here's kind of an overview of one of our misbed systems. And we're going to go into the parts in a little more detail as we go along here. But you see in this case, we actually have some grapes that are in the mist bed. We're going to talk about the way the water comes into the system and the way the, in this case, it's an automatic leaf rather than a clock. We'll talk about both here as we go along. But the way this is set up is that I've got the water comes in from this side. The automatic leaf is what engages releasing the water. to the system. We'll talk a little bit about the bottom heat here in a second as well. All right. Here we have kind of effectively two different setups for bottom heat, with this being the sort of older style that we've used, this kind of red mat, you know, resistance style bottom heat. The downside with this is through checking with an infrared device to see temperature, you can see that there are definitely hot spots across a given mat. And we were looking to do some rooting studies, and that was going to just throw an extra variable into the mix that we really couldn't account for. And so what we decided to do was build this sand bed type structure over here. We went on campus at UC Davis and looked at every single mist system that we could find on campus, and then basically made a hybrid of the whole thing. The way this is set up is that I've got kind of the black tabletop kind of type structure, and then on top of that we put a thick insulation that we then drilled holes into, and then I put a landscape fabric, because we were then putting sand on top of that, and I didn't want all my sand just to run out on me. And so we did about 2 inches of sand, and then running up and down this bed is a heating cable. And then on top of that is about another 5 inches of, I think it's 30 mesh, I think is the type of sand that we used, another piece of landscape fabric, and then about 2 more inches of a little bit thicker sand on top of that, with the desire of trying to keep it from sticking quite so much to the trays that we had in there. And with that, we got a pretty even heat across the bed. The one real downside with this, and I knew it going into it, was that one, I was going to fight the weeds, and then the second thing is, you remember those ant farms as a kid? So I've made possibly the world's largest ant farm right there. And so every once in a while, I just have to treat the bed. I knew that was going to be an issue I was going to wrestle with, but I've been very happy with the way the system has worked in general. And so I just use a simple thermostat for running the heating. In this case, it's the red mats because we got three coming off of it. In the other case, I have just a single plug-in coming out for the single line running through. I don't know if I remember to mention in the back last slide. So we're running 75 to 80 degrees Fahrenheit for our bottom heat. All right, the mist end of all of this. As you can see here, I have this type of emitter. It's a plastic type emitter. We used to have metal emitters, and they had a much smaller orifice. And the problem that I found with those is they would clog. If you used any of that kind of like a plumber's tape, that would tend to come free and clog the orifice. Or the other thing that we were fighting with, even though we have super clean water, was algae. And so we did two things. One, with this particular emitter, one, are pretty inexpensive, easy to clean, larger orifice. And then the other thing we did is we actually painted the pipe black, and that really minimized any of the algae problems that we were having. All right, so here once again, you've got kind of an overview of the whole mist bed structure. All right, so here's the automatic leaf. As you can see, this structure right here is the leaf part, if you will. And the way it works is that the water goes off, lands on that leaf structure, weighs it down, and that shuts off the water at that point in time. And then as the water evaporates from it, the leaf comes up and then engages the solenoid to open up the water. Really great from the perspective that it's really dynamic. That say you have a cool morning or cloudy morning, then you have a hot afternoon. You have different frequencies of mist going off with that particular style of controlling your mist versus the clock, which just goes like a robot regardless of what your outside conditions are. The downside, everything comes with its cons, is that here you can see we have some grapes, some little bit larger leafed cuttings that were here, and someone put one of the cutting containers in there and wasn't paying attention to the leaf. Well, the leaf was down, and then that leaf covered over that leaf, and I came in and saw things rather dry and realized that, you know, this was keeping it from going up. So like anything, you just have to pay attention as you deal with such things. But I've been really happy with this particular system. So here's the sort of, we'll call older style clock, where it just, you know, goes, like I said, like a robot. I actually use this in my hardening off area, and I'm quite happy with that. We've used it in another one of our greenhouses where we mostly propagate grapes, and it's worked fantastic for that as well. All right, so here we see some cuttings that are just about ready to be, actually they were planted on this particular day. As you can see, it takes about 2.5 months for us to get the roots that we were to be happy to be potting these guys up. All right, so here you see Brendan, who was an intern that particular year, holding up one of the cuttings that was just pulled out. We're going to get a little closer to that, look at that in a second. So here's obviously a little closer look of the root system on that cutting. And here is possibly one of what I consider one of the most important aspects of being successful with your cuttings. You can get 100% rooting and then lose them at the potting phase, because these guys suffer like mad at that point in time. Within minutes, we'll see them start to wilt on us. And so what I do is, just about as fast as we get them potted up, we bring them right back to the mist system, and they might stay there a couple days to a week, depending upon how fast we can kind of move things through that particular room. Just adjacent to this, I have a hardening off area where we're still doing mist, but less frequent. And then off to this side is a bench that's not getting any mist at all. And so it's still in the same room where it's a little bit more humid, but like I said, kind of slowly pulling it off of that humidity. And we had much greater success by using that particular route. So here you can see some of the freshly potted up pomegranates. And so that leads us into the media that we end up using. And we use what I call our one-to-one-to-one by volume media. And as you can see, it's one part peat moss, one part perlite, and one part super soil, which is basically shredded bark. And I personally like using the Miracle-Gro peat moss because it's already broken up. It's already hydrated. You know, we've used that, the bale style in the past. And it takes so much effort to ultimately end up hydrating that peat moss, because it's so hydrophobic, that I found that even though this is a little bit more pricey as far as the original bag, just time-wise, it was so much more efficient. Plus, everything comes in 2-cubic-foot bags, so it makes it extremely easy to work out your ratios. The other plus side is, honestly, I can buy it all from Home Depot, and I can get it by the pallet. And so we're very fortunate that across the street from us is Foundation Plants. And what we're looking at here is a steam sterilizer. And honestly, it's not so much the sterilization that I'm worried about. It's the fact that inside here is an auger. And so we can put the bags of material into it. And rather than all the handwork we used to do, this machine mixes it up nicely for us. And then we have a nice sterile product at the end. And we're going to see it in a second. Right inside here, I'll just bring the forklift in with a macro bin, and then this auger just pushes the soil out nicely for us, and so it works out very efficient. And so here you can see a macro bin with soil in it. These are tall 1-gallon containers, which I'm growing most of our trees in. And in this particular case, we were actually going to pot up some walnuts. So here's a little close-up of the soil just so you get a little bit of a feel for it. All right, pest problems. Fortunately, this is about it as far as the greenhouse is concerned. Aphids come on fast and furious. You'll see them in the while the cuttings are still in the mist system, and they will definitely slow down the growth of your plants. So I will either hit them with water to try and knock them off. Sometimes that's enough to just knock the population down. Or soaps is another route. If I have a high enough population, then I'll move into pyrethrins, because the other issue is that I'm typically treating for ants, and they go kind of hand in hand with each other, and if I can manage the ants, then I minimize my other pest problems. All right, so now we're going to go into a little overview of how the collection came together. So here is by far my busiest slide that we have, but it'll give you a little information about how the collection came together. Our oldest trees in the collection are what I'll refer to as our old block or C block, and we're actually going to come back to that and talk about that in just a few moments. So somewhere late 80s is when our new block, our A block, went in. And as you can see, we've got a handful of ornamental varieties. That first row in particular has a lot of ornamental varieties, which we're going to get to see at the latter part of today's talk. And then in 1990, we received five ornamental Japanese varieties. They're absolutely outstanding as far as their flowering qualities. There's only one in particular, Hakubutan, that I really like from its fruiting perspective, but like I said, we're going to get to see that in just a little bit. And then the next thing is really kind of quite important. In 1995, we received the first of the material that came from Turkmenistan. And at that point in time, our then curator, Dr. George White, went to Turkmenistan. I'm assuming met Dr. Gregory Levin. You may have heard that name before. And so this was sort of the first bridge of getting this material to us that would later be really important, where we end up getting, probably the better part of 90 varieties from that Turkmenistan collection. 1996, we received a bunch of varieties, 19 varieties from Todd, who I see out in the audience here. Todd has been really influential on the repository, brought lots of great things to us, and we're certainly really thankful for the relationship we have with him and the CRFG for bringing material to the repository. 96 and 97, we got material from John LaRocca and John Chater, which people in the room may be much more familiar with John Chater than I am. My understanding with that material is that he was looking at material that was going to do well in coastal regions. And one of my personal favorites of that collection is Purple Heart, which we're going to get to see a little later on. Also in 1997, we got 22 accessions from Mike Hotchkiss, who's also a USDA guy. He was in Byron, Georgia. And what was important with this material is that they had received material from, Turkmenistan, but it was also probably from Azerbaijan, from the then Soviet Union collection. And that material was important because it was brought in because of its cold hardiness. And so in that particular area in Georgia, they were looking for varieties that could stand the winters there. And now it's holding greater importance as people are trying to push pomegranates into, we'll say, non-traditional locations for growing them. A lot of material out of that, I would also say, is kind of more suitable for juicing because, on the whole, it was harder seeded material. All right, now we're going to come back to that old block, and Todd can set me straight as to whether or not the next story I'm going to tell you is correct. My understanding is that Todd and George went out to that particular block of about 50 trees, and there was an article by Dr. John Lovell in Fruit Gardener magazine that was describing certain varieties that were in that particular row. And my understanding is that this gentleman was a psychologist, and he brought his class out there, and he asked people, describe what you taste. And so names like crab and cranberry and sour and Eve and May came out of that particular grouping. And so what Todd and George did was, based on the information in that article, figured out what trees were associated with those numbers that were in that. Is that pretty reasonable?
That's correct. The Pam Yugo was there also, and it was at that time when we determined that those all had come from
people. Okay. Gotcha. Do you have any idea how old they are, Tom?
Oh, well, they definitely go back to the 1920s.
All right. And so in 1999 is really when we got a large cluster of material from Dr. Gregory Levin. And this is, and I got to meet Dr. Feldman earlier this year. I got a chance to take a trip to Arizona, and he had gone to Turkmenistan and was involved in collecting this material. And it's some of the greatest material that we have in the collection. And the story is really kind of ultimately a very sad story in that the Soviet Union was falling apart, or had fallen apart, and really they were looking at these orchards as potential firewood. And so he had the vision to realize that he needed to send this material out. As you can see, we got about 65 accessions. My understanding is about half of them were sent because he thought they were elite material, and half for genetic diversity reasons. And so some of my favorite varieties in the collection came out of that material that was in that what we received. In 2006, our then curator, Dr. Ed Stover, went to both Georgia and Armenia and brought back 11 accessions. And then in 2006, David Silverstein, who I've worked with quite a bit, gave us the first of the Indian material that we have. And then in 2007, Dr. Dharam Sharma brought us some more Indian material. And then in 2007, our geneticist, Molly Aradia, went to Azerbaijan and brought back another 16 accessions of pomegranates. And I forgot to add it to the slide, but last year he brought back another six or so varieties from Azerbaijan. And in about 10 days, he's leaving for Georgia to try and go collect some more material as well. All right, distribution. So one of the services that the repository does is distribute material. Oh, I forgot to tell you guys, I have some pamphlets up here. They'll tell you about the repository. Did anyone out here get to see Bernie Prinz talk a little bit earlier? Very good, okay. So Bernie went a little bit into what the repository does. One of the functions that we do is we distribute the material that we have in the collection. So you guys would place an order, and then it would be collected in the field, brought back to this at the Davis location, kept in our walk-in coolers, and then we would start to break down given plant types, if you will. And so in this case, these are all pomegranates that we're looking at. Every single one of these white tags represents another an individual order from you guys. And so we put these things together, bag them up, get them inspected, get the proper paperwork from the county, and then send them out at that point in time. So I gathered a little information about over the last 14 years of what the distribution numbers were. Remember how I mentioned earlier, you know, there wasn't much interest in pomegranates. And as you can see, back in 1996, there just wasn't a whole lot at one order. But we had more or less kind of a steady increase of orders. And then all of a sudden, in 2004, we had this massive increase that took place. But we're going to get back to that just a second. So as you can see, like I said, kind of a steady increase in the number of orders. And this represents the number of accessions that we sent out. This doesn't mean different accessions, but we may have had, say, 20 orders for a given accession, that kind of thing. Now back to 2004. Had a tasting in 2003, and Laramie Trevino came to the tasting, and she wrote an article for the San Francisco Chronicle that talked about the repository and how we distributed material. I get a phone call from our geneticist, Molly, on a Saturday, and he's telling me, the fax machine is just blowing up, the phones are ringing. And I'm thinking, wow, that's great. You know, we're getting order after order. And by Monday, I was thinking, this might not be so good. They might not like me so much at this point in time. But this was really a statement about the repository. Everybody came together, and we worked as a unit, and we got those orders all pushed out. Like I said, a quantity that we've never seen before, but we got it done. All right, another thing that the repository puts on are tastings. And so here's a little pregame, if you will. The 2 days before the tasting, I typically hold it on a Saturday, and typically hold it the first Saturday of November. That gives us enough time to have collected, really, all the varieties that are going to come to fruition and put together a small army of volunteers to start cracking out the arrows. One method that we use is basically splitting them and then using the sort of thumb method, if you will, underwater and popping the arrows out, and then quite literally took it to a salad spinner to dry these things off. Another way of doing this that we did in particular last year was sort of this cut the fruit in half and smack it, if you will, that kind of thing. Very effective, but there are certain varieties where the arrows are a little bit more tenacious, and all you do is make juice at that point in time. So you have to be a little selective about the way you approach all of that. So here is a view of the tasting itself, and really the way I set it up is going what would kind of be from top to or bottom to top, is that I put the sweet varieties heading into the tart varieties, and Hakobotan being at this end, being a tart variety. And let's discuss that for a second too, because I think there's some confusion when talking about the term sweet. When I refer to sweet, I'm talking about something that really has basically no acid that you can perceive. And then sweet tart being in the middle, and then tart being at this end. Of course, you can have sort of variations where you have a sweet tart a little on the sweet side, or a sweet tart a little on the tart side, that kind of thing. All right, so now we're going to go into the various fruiting varieties. But first, I thought we'd kind of talk about fruit development. And so what we have here are a picture of a female flower and then male flower. I'll refer to that, but really they're hermaphroditic flowers. But we're going to get a little closer view of these guys in a second. One of the reasons I bring this up is that I get a question with great frequency. You know, I have all of this flower drop. What's going on? Well, the first question I ask, well, was it a male flower or a female flower? Generally, the answer is there's male flowers and female flowers. And so that's why I show this to you, because the male flowers will drop off. And so that's just normal. There's definitely some female flower drop-off that takes place. It's believed that in that particular case, it just didn't get pollinated to a great enough degree to stay on. May have been, you know, over-fertilization or over-watering or something of that particular nature. So here we can see the male flower on the left and the female flower on the right. The way I look at these is the male is kind of more what I call V-shaped, and the female a little bit more peanut-shaped. And then from variety to variety, you'll see slight differences in kind of the shape of the flowers, length, width, that kind of stuff, color. So here you can see the male flower cut in half and the female flower. You can see the pistil of the female flower here and the ovary there. And you can see how reduced, or hopefully you can see it, how reduced the pistil is in this male flower and how sort of diminished that ovary type area is. Alright, so now we're going to go a little further in development. So we can see the female flower here starting to swell a little bit further along. And then an interesting thing starts to happen. And from variety to variety, you have different things that take place. But in the case of Parthianka, we start to see this area go from red starting to turn green. And a little bit more so. And then at this stage, we can see that the neck, the calyx end, is this beautiful sort of pink color. This is what I refer to as the lipstick stage. And then we start to see it revert back to this red color again. And then finally, that's its final stage. All right, so we're going to start with soft-seeded types. And we're going to start with Sinpepe, Deepon 82. This is one of the one of my favorite of the sweet pink types. I got to preface this by saying that my preference is for a sweet tart or a little bit even more tart type. But certainly the soft seeds make this thing really interesting. If it was just a sweet type with hard seeds, which we do have in the collection. I wouldn't be nearly as interested in it. As a nice kind of mild flavor, I think that they're actually particularly tasty when served cold. This one's of some interest because we really didn't know what the name was for quite some time. And so many years ago, David Silverstein was out with me, and we were tasting it for the first time. And you may have heard the name Pink Ice. Well, Dave said to me, "That's like Pink Ice," when we looked at that thing, and that's where that name came from. And then Pink Satin is the name that Dave Wilson Nursery sells it under. But talking with Kay Ryugo again, he said that originally it was called Sin Pepe, so without seed. And so that's where the name comes from. And what I tried to do, not with all of the varieties, but in many cases I have pictures of the fruit kind of cut up in different ways, if you will. And what I was trying to capture was, like in this case, how the carpels are divided, how much membrane that we have in here, how thick the rind is. Many of them are. We're in the process of getting more pictures up as well. And so here you can see kind of a split picture where we can see the two worlds. So you can see the top world here, and then you can see the bottom world in this case.
On the website, do you specify whether it came from the coastal selection that's poor or from the abundant?
Well, there's various information on there. Not all of them have all of the information, and that's one of the things that I'm hoping for us to accomplish in the near future, is get a lot more information ultimately up on RIM. But you can certainly contact me, and I will gladly talk to you or email me or whatever, and I'll give you hopefully all the information that you're interested in. And a little close-up of the arrows there. Madovi Vasha. So this is a sweet type that came to us from the Turkmenistan collection. The name translates to honey. What's of interest for this variety is you can see red rinds. People are really interested in red, both inside and outside. Ultimately, say from a commercial perspective, I think red sells. And so that's part of what's of interest. And that's why I think ultimately as we get to see some of these varieties, the ones that aren't, we'll call, as attractive from a color perspective, I think would be great at a farmer's market where people could actually get to taste them and then realize how good some of these varieties are, even if it wasn't their eyes that called them to it in the first place. This one also puts on a ridiculous amount of fruit, so much so that it just wants to split the tree. So very, very fruitful. As you can see, quite dark there. And then, yeah, the arrows, yes, exactly. Sirenevi is my favorite of the sweet types. To me, it's got the most complex flavor of the bunch. It's a little quirky in the sense it's one of the later varieties to come to harvest, in some cases as late as early November, and so you kind of run a little bit of risk with that of, you know, splitting and all the other potential damage that comes from, say, the wind bouncing around, not so much with sunburn, but really more wind and kind of rain damage. But when it's allowed to go to fruition, beautiful red color, another variety that came to us from Turkmenistan. All right, Parfianca. You may have heard of this one before. This is one of my favorite varieties in the collection. When it's a good year for it, it's hard to beat. Excellent sweet tart flavor, soft seed, red rind, red arrow, just really nice piece of fruit. The bummer with it is the last couple of years or so when we had really hot summers where we were located in winters, it had a little harder time coloring up, as did most of the collection. We just were having a hard time getting the great red color on the outside, not as good a color on the inside, and then hence not as wonderful a berry flavor as I got to experience in the past. Well, we're going to get to see another variety by the name of Ariana that did stunningly well under those weather conditions. All right, Gasarski Rosavoy. This one is one of those ones I would call under the not as attractive looking type rhyme, but also very soft seeded, excellent sweet tart flavor to it. Another variety that came to us from Turkmenistan. Excellent tasting variety. All right, Mayako Semyami Rosavoy, which means pink soft-seeded variety. And the reason I put this one into the group is that it reflects some of the strong citrus flavors that you get with pomegranates, in particular more of a grapefruit flavor with this one. I think it has a little bit more astringency than many varieties, and I think that's why I perceive that particular flavor with it. Also soft-seeded, but a little bit more gritty to the seed, if you will. Ariana, so this is one I mentioned just a moment ago. This one has been a phenomenal performer the last 2 years. When most of the other varieties did not perform as well, this one did fantastic. Colored up great, both inside and outside. It's a variety that I would historically say with sweet tart, emphasis on the tart side, but really the last 2 years have been a very well-balanced fruit, extremely soft-seeded, and for good or for bad, I mean, we had melon-sized fruit that were coming off of this tree. Though in 2008, across the board, whatever it was about that particular year, we had really large fruit. Maybe because we had flowering a little earlier, so they had a little more time to grow. I'm not quite certain what all was involved with that, but we had fantastic, huge fruit. So if I was in a particularly hot area, this one I'd like to trial and see how well it does where other varieties aren't working nearly as well. But where we are up in winters, it's doing fantastic. Moa Nabis, another soft-seeded red variety, red rind, red arrows. This one is a sweet tart, emphasis on the tart side. So if you like a variety that's a little bit more tart, this would be one to go with. Also, really nice berry flavor. All right, now we're going to move into the medium soft to medium seeds, or what I'll refer to as tweener types, because what you find, as you can see up there, they're good for either fresh eating or juice. As we start to head into harder seeds, and I start looking at them more as a juice type than a fresh eating type. And so certainly the most famous of the bunch is Wonderful. It's a standard variety, been around since the 1890s, does very well up and down California, certainly does very well where we're at. Very consistent performer, a little bit more astringency to it, so a little bit more of a wine-like characteristic to it, what I call a little bit more of an adult flavor, if you will. And like I said, the standard variety, Paramount's got 18,000 plus acres of it at this point in time. So if you've tasted a pomegranate in the supermarket, you can pretty much guarantee this is what you're tasting. And you know, we talked about that red rind earlier. I was told that industry believes that 50% of the fruit that's bought in the supermarket is never eaten. It's just put on the table as display. And so that's why you see, you know, this attraction to the red color. And certainly the fruit that, you know, most of us as kids growing up in California, you may not have had a pomegranate tree in your front yard, but you knew where that one tree was in the neighborhood, right? And as a kid, you'd go and find that one tree and you'd go grab yourself a pomegranate and you'd sit on the curb and you'd eat that thing because you didn't dare come in the house with it, right? But I've heard the same story over and over again that I remember as a kid with such. And it's also what I would say, you know, the flavor that I think most of us are used to is that was the one variety that was available. Purple Heart. I'll stop for 1 second just because, you know, something occurred to me as I was talking about what has also been fascinating with putting on the tastings is that you'll find that there are definite, what I'll call sort of ethnic attractions to flavor. And that's why when someone tells me or asks me, what's the best pomegranate? You know, that's really hard to answer. I can tell you what I like and why I like it, but we may have totally different palates as far as that's kind of concerned. Where I found people really attracted to the sweet varieties, which are not the thing that I would particularly go towards, but really because, say, they had soft seed, or, say, sweet tart on the sweet side, because that's what they grew up with, Persians in particular. Say, oh, I want a sweet pomegranate, but really what I've kind of gathered, sweet tart with a little tendency to the sweet side. So, Purple Heart. So I mentioned this one earlier, but this is one of the John Chater varieties. Definitely my favorite of the bunch. I mean, Eversweet is another variety you may have heard of, but so that would be a soft-seeded sweet type. In this case, a little crunchier seed, but excellent color both outside and inside. Sweet tart, little emphasis on the tart side, but very prolific fruiting. Good crop every single year. I see very little sunburn on this, very little cracking. The other thing of interest is one year I had a couple bags of pomegranates in my garage I was going to juice, and I kept saying, okay, I'll do it tomorrow. I'll do it on the weekend, and it just kept sitting there. And this guy lasted far longer than any other variety without breaking down, without being in any kind of refrigeration at all. So whatever it is about it, it's definitely got a really good holding ability. Ink, you may have heard of this one. This one's done quite well in the tastings. This one's from our older block. Also a little crunchier seed, a touch more astringency to this particular variety. Really, really good flavor and good color. Caraballo Mirasol. I put this one in because this is one of the varieties that came from my conscious from the Byron, Georgia collection. This was one that Levin rated really well for juice. Like I said, we're kind of getting into these little bit harder seeds, but also very important because of its cold tolerance and probably originally from Azerbaijan. All right, medium hard to hard seed types, juice types. So Sakertzi is one of my favorite, once again, from the material from Byron, Georgia. More of a kind of shrubby type, if you will. If given the time, it'll ripen up to this beautiful red color. Has lumber-like seeds inside this thing, so I don't see it really as a sort of fresh eating type, but excellent flavored juice. Alster and Nar, which probably should actually be Shirin Nar, because Shirin means sweet, Nar means pomegranate. This is a very large pomegranate, very fast growing, very upright growing tree. It has more of these kind of punch-like flavors, if you will, that kind of thing. Also a bit of a piece of lumber sitting inside of this thing. It's hard seed, yeah, you better believe it. Cargol. I put this one into here because I get the question, do you have the black pomegranate? We do not have the black pomegranate, but we do have, this is the darkest one we have in the collection. Cara means dark red or black, and gol means flower. It's a sweet tart on the tart side variety, a little crunchier seed. The downside with this guy that we found is it seems to get heart rot quite readily compared to other varieties. And I did include a picture of the flower in this particular case. Spice type. This one also came from Todd. Daru, so I'm told, comes from the Himalayas. This is, you may have heard of Anardana, an Indian spice. And so this particular variety is supposedly used for that. It's a pretty small pomegranate, but I included that for part of sort of the diversity of the thing.
How did they make the spice?
That I can't tell you because I've never done it before. So now we're getting into the ornamental varieties. Yeah, you probably never saw flowers like this on a pomegranate. Just unbelievable carnation-like looking flowers. Some of them produce fruit, some of them don't. But just absolutely stunning. All right, double red white. So this is double red white here, and actually as the flower sits a little longer, as it dries, it'll take on a bit of a white color, and I think that's where the name originally comes from. Because as I looked at this flower originally, I'm like, where does double red white come from? But like I said, absolutely stunning looking flowers. Kiza Kuro, this is one of these varieties. The Kuro means pomegranate. One of these varieties that came to us from a nursery in Japan. This is one of these what I call candy cane type, where you have that sort of a red and white or pink and white, which we'll see a little bit different theme in a moment. Once again, really beautiful looking flowers. No fruit on that variety. Torio Shibori. So a pinkish looking flower, and in this case it does produce fruit, but not really very good fruit. Nochi Shibori. So here's what I was talking about, a little bit different theme on that sort of red and white kind of type structure. Hakubotan. This is my favorite of the Japanese varieties, but it is not for the faint of heart. It is an extremely tart variety, very lemon-like. It's not the first variety I would take you out to taste in the in our orchard. I refer to it as liquid fire, but it is excellent. I really like it. It has a crunchy seed, which when I was looking at these varieties originally, I was looking at soft seed as being something that would kind of trump everything. And about once a year we have the CIA come out to our fields. And by that I mean the Culinary Institute of America. And I had a gal who I let try this particular fruit, and she made a comment to me that made me think about these things in a way that I'd never thought about before. She said, this would be great in a salad, which, okay, yeah. Because unlike an almond, which you put in there and with the vinaigrette softens up relatively quickly, the seed doesn't in this particular case. And so if you were looking to add a little crunch to your salad with the color and the flavor of the pomegranate, you could use something of this particular nature. So it just tells you, it's all about marketing, right, when everything's said and done. But really, really interesting variety. White flowered variety, as you can see with the yellow rind that we had. So no anthocyanins in this one at all, as you're going to get to see in a second. This yellow rind with these clear to yellowish arils. Really interesting, really different from really anything else in the collection. You know, some of these lighter colored ones I've heard people try to market as non-staining, right? That kind of. Dodge Librelli. So this was one of the early items to come to us when that first wave of material came from Turkmenistan. Another really stunning red double variety. You can see located on the tree here?
Are these dwarf?
Yes, the Doxa gravida is, yes. As you can see, it does produce fruit, but once again, not the greatest in the world. Wheel 42. This one is a really bizarre one. I don't know if you can see it or not. We're going to get a little closer in a second. There's two different kinds of flowers on this particular tree. According to Molly, our geneticist, says it's a transposable element. Don't ask me what that means, because I'm really not certain. But that's what he thinks is why we're seeing this. It's not like it's a single occurrence, but you have multiple branches that you can trace a whole branch up, and it'll be the same flower type throughout it. Here you can see a little closer look. And a little overexposed, you can kind of really see sort of the ruffling, if you will, of the flower here, and then we got a little buddy that was in there with us too. And then there's the other flower type on it. Hygenar, Kermizi, Kabah. You see, I have the C there. As I was looking at some of the stuff that the writings of Dr. Levin, I could see that there was this Chydrenar in the thing, and I'm fairly certain that that's what this was supposed to be spelled as, because the Chydrenar was this dwarf Chico cross, as we'll get to see. What I find really interesting about this variety, it's a pretty low-growing, say 5 to 6 feet tall tree that I see. I picture as kind of like a patio tree, maybe in like a half barrel, that kind of thing. Extremely prolific fruit producer. Not very big fruit, you know, relatively small, but very ornamental, very attractive, as you can see like that. And remember I said earlier that half the fruit isn't eaten. It's just put on the table. So I saw this as one of these varieties that maybe potentially fit that kind of a niche. You know, like I said, very ornamental variety. It's not that it's not edible. It's pretty tart and pretty crunchy seeded. So it's just not going to be your favorite variety from that perspective. Yeah, sure. Sure. A little close up. And with that, I say thank you very much.
Much water, so concentrate on that, and thank you to Jeff.